Welcome to Breakthrough Success. I'm your host, Mark Alberti, the content marketing expert, bringing you 5 new episodes every week where I and top-level guests teach you how to take your business to the next level and achieve your breakthrough. Hello, Breakthrough Success listeners. I just wanted you all to know before the episode actually starts, I've been working a little bit behind the scenes to give you something really special. So a while ago, I wrote my book, Content Marketing Secrets, which helps people create, promote, and optimize their content for growth and revenue. And I just put the finishing touches together to offer that for free to anyone who is interested. So if you want your free copy of Content Marketing Secrets, all you have to do is head over to markgaberti.com/book. Now, let's jump right into the episode. One of the things that we find difficult when it comes to growing our businesses is it's not always entirely the journey that is difficult. It is that sense of continuing to move forward, continuing to put in the work, and also feeling connected with ourselves, because we could be putting in so much work, pursuing so many opportunities that we forget a few things about ourselves. We go in different paths that may not be a strong reflection of our values as we'd like. So we have this like subconscious feeling that we are not fully connected with ourselves. And that's where motivation drops. That's where work is at a lower performance. So constantly being connected with yourself is something that's very important from a personal development standpoint and a business standpoint. So that's why we're going to talk about staying connected with ourselves and reconnecting with ourselves when we get disconnected from ourselves in this episode. So today's guest is an author, speaker, facilitator, and master of experiential learning design for co-creating workplace and community cultures with vitality. She has over 35 years of experience working in, advocating for, and learning how to engage through embodied experience. She is the author of the book, Trust Your Senses. But today's guest for episode 233, without any further ado, is Deb Lange. Deb, it is such a pleasure to have you on the show.
Hi, Mark. It's such a pleasure to be here from down under.
Deb, I'm really happy to have you on the show. And this idea that like we have to continue to stay connected with ourselves, it sounds like something that something that's very basic. But when we like disconnect from the work that we're doing, when we disconnect like in from ourselves in any way, from an important piece of ourselves, like that's something that we need to fix right away. And we have to get a better idea of what it truly means for us to be connected with ourselves. So I'm wondering if you could just give us some backstory first. So can you talk about why you decided to write Trust Your Senses and get into like helping people connect and reconnect?
Yeah, sure. Well, one of the biggest things I think that I realized along the way is because I've been on the path of personal and professional development for myself and then helping others in both business and also the community all my life, is that it seemed like most of us, the path that we take is we learn lots and lots of information. A lot of it's very abstract today. A lot of it's very conceptual. And that gets us so far with technical information. We can go into our jobs, but then we can get so far with that, and then we bump up against things, which are usually people. I mean, we don't work in isolation from people. We work with people. We work with ourselves. And it's when we're bumping up against people that we often then have conflict, confusion, misunderstandings, whatever, that get in the way of us all wanting to do a good job and work together. And it's often when we're not connected. So if we're just talking in abstract terms all the time and we're not connecting at a more human level, at a more emotional level, at a more sensory level, we're just worlds apart. We just don't understand one another. We don't have empathy. We don't have compassion. We don't sense that somebody's misunderstanding what we're actually saying, or so we might rattle on the whole time and think everyone in the room knows what's going on. But if I'm disconnected, I can't actually sense that people don't understand. And if I haven't created the safety within myself to be vulnerable and say, well, actually, I'm not sure what's going on, you know, do people understand or don't they, I won't ask the question because I won't want to appear vulnerable. So I need it to be vulnerable. I need to be connected because I need to feel safe in myself to do that. And then to allow others to feel safe enough to be vulnerable and say, yeah, well, actually, I didn't understand that. I need to know more. Or, no, I don't agree with you. So to say to someone, I don't agree with you, requires a sense of safety and connection, to listen to diverse opinions. So it seemed to me that people have great intentions for themselves and in business, and then when we disconnect, there's huge misunderstandings, and it prevents us from then generating and creating the things that we're most passionate about. But then the more we connect to ourselves, the more we're connected, mind, body, and energy, the more we have a sense of our own safety, our own needs, our own perception of what's going on for us, how we're affecting others, and then our own, how we're limiting or creating our own success. But then we can also sense how connected we are to the people that we're working with or our customers, and then help create the environment where other people are feeling connected. When human beings have a huge need for connection, a sense of belonging, and that sense of belonging is within ourselves and with others, the people around us, you know, beginning from families to, you know, our workplaces and the places where we go in our communities for, you know, sport and health and recreation. So it was me seeing this gap, and I suppose a lot of that gap in a way over the years has been filled now with the prevailing work in emotional intelligence and then also mindfulness. But then I went down those paths too, and I developed a lot of work in those areas. But then I felt there was another step to take. And that step, which I call, is shifting the focus from thinking, which we're all so good at because we've been trained to think from the minute we were born and went to school. It's so focused on thinking that it's like we've got so good at that, we've forgotten there's all these other parts of human potential that I call within the realm of our senses that are still underdeveloped. And when we start focusing on sensing, not just thinking and not just feeling, but sensing, it opens up a whole new world. It actually brings us more together, more connected within ourselves, and more develops the ability to connect with others. So I've said a lot there. Have you got... Did you make sense of anything I said? What other questions have you got around anything I've said so far?
One of the things that I do want to talk about is for like when you're in business and you set a goal for yourself and you don't do it, like let's say it's write 1,000 words for your upcoming book and you don't do that goal, you repeat that like over and over again where you set the goal, but something happens, you're not able to do it. And I feel like that's where part of the disconnect can happen. You continue to set a goal that you know you have to do it. You know it's something that you're working towards. It's better for yourself in the long term. It's something that helps you to achieve your vision, but you may not necessarily be doing that work, feeling that sense of disconnect. So if you are in that situation, how can we reconnect with ourselves and get back to consistently going out there and achieving our goals?
Well, you've given quite a clear example, which is really great. So it's almost like when we think about setting a goal in that way, it depends where we're coming from. And if we're coming from almost a belief that we can control and force ourselves to do something because we can think about it and we can set it down and we can make ourselves do it, that comes from a certain set of beliefs around control and domination, and it's control and domination of self or control and domination of others and the world. And yes, it can be quite disconnected from our whole self. So I can think, oh, I want to do this thing. Now, maybe where's that thought come from? Has it come from my parents, my teachers, the people around me that they're doing that thing that, oh, I think I should be doing that thing? But maybe if I was really connected to myself, it's actually not for me. It's not the right thing for me. It's not my path. It's not, whereas if I really connected with my whole self, I might choose another path or another goal, and I have all the energy in the world for it, and I'm not forcing myself to do it. It's actually flowing because it's actually, I'm coming from a really connected place and I have just got the energy to do it. So does that make sense? That we can force ourselves to do something and that it's hard work, or we can, if we're doing something that's really aligned to who we are and very connected, we've got the energy and it will flow and it becomes a habit and we will just do it for ourselves. So to make that connection is what I call, it's really dropping from head into our bodies and really sensing our whole presence in our body, that we're not just our mind, we're not just our thoughts. We are actually in our bodies, or we're more than our body as well, but and we're more than energy. I mean, we're a whole being, which is something that we can sense. So if we drop into our bodies and really, we'll start with feel the energy associated with doing that goal of writing 1,000 words a day. Now, maybe if I start connecting, I might connect with fear associated with it. And that fear might be associated with failure. So I'm constantly sabotaging myself. I'm setting a goal. I want to write 1,000 words a day. But I'm not connecting to the fear. And you connect to lots of things, but as an example, perhaps I'm not connecting to the fear. And where's the fear coming from? Well, the fear's connected to, well, I don't want to fail. So where did that come from? Well, society, you know, at one stage in life I had a teacher that judged me or made a fool of me or shamed me in front of a class. So I've got this sense that I don't want to fail, but I want to do this thing, but I've got this deep sense of failure and fear and shame, so I'm stopping myself doing it. So there's a disconnect. So I actually need to connect to that source of what's stopping me, which isn't normally another thought, it's another feeling. And it's normally a sense in our body. And when I connect to it, it's like when you notice something, it's like if I said to you now, look around the room and see everything that's red. And all of a sudden, all the red things appear and everything fades away. And so if for the first time I've started noticing, oh, yes, I've got fear associated with this 1,000 words every day, it's like it's almost like giving it a voice. It's giving it a space to be alive. It's not hidden anymore. It's not locked away. It's not, and so it can free itself. It can free itself. I can actually understand where this block is coming from. And through just connecting with that, sometimes it's as simple as making that connection, and then there is almost like a release in the body of the energy, the blocked energy, and then I can create a new way. Well, okay, if I did feel shame at some stage and all the rest of it, okay, I'm now, you know, an adult. This is something I really do want to do for myself. What is it that I need to do to overcome that fear? Is it that I need to find a partner who also wants to do something similar? And we support one another. And I support one another in that I'm going to share my words that I write with that person so that I won't feel shame and humiliation when I share the words. I'll feel support and connection, or that I'll read what I write to somebody, or I'll start posting them as a blog, and so that I can start having a sense of people reading my work and that I'm not feeling ashamed of what I'm writing. Does that make sense?
I mean, I really like, yeah, it makes a lot of sense because it's basically like tapping into, well, what's stopping you from accomplishing the goal? What's the cause of the disconnect? And trying to see how we can disconnect ourselves from the thing that is disconnecting us from the goal. So, I know I used a fancy phrase there. I think that made sense, but I really think that just getting to the idea of what is holding us back from our goals can make a really big difference. And on that theme of holding back, I'm wondering, what do you believe holds most people back from being connected with their whole selves?
Well, going back to that example of even just setting a goal for yourself to write 1,000 words every day, normally, we're born, and we're born these beautiful bundles of joy and potential and all the rest of it. But along the way, through, even if we've had loving parents, a loving family, whatever, things happen in life. And we make them mean that somebody's just judged us, somebody's made me feel ashamed, somebody's made me feel not good enough, I'm not worthy enough, I'm not perfect enough, I'm not this enough, I'm not that enough. So that all happens between 0 and 20. And then it's between 20 and, or 20 and the rest of your life, but maybe between 20 and 40. Or I think between 20 and 30, you go out there, you're gung-ho, and you really, right, I've got all these things that I want to achieve in life. And I know that you're only young, Mark, so I'm not sure whether you already feel a sense of things that are stopping you, or maybe you are still in this realm of, I can do anything, anything's possible, and I'm just really going for it. But often when people get to maybe late 20s, early 30s, they've started to achieve some success in life, but then there are some things that they go, oh, I have never done that, or I've always seemed stuck on that, or there's this one thing that, I've always wanted to do, but I've always been stuck on doing that. And then people start to explore the stuck areas of their life, of the blocks, and then it's sort of going through a period of, well, it can be, it doesn't have to be, because people can stay stuck all their lives on certain areas. But then it seems like to the people I've worked with, there's an illumination of, yes, I'm successful in these areas, but I'm not as successful as I would like to be in these. So there's something that's stopping me in these areas, and it tends to be the things that have come from our earlier years, that we have, when we were very young, we did the best we could with the skills we had at the time, but often the strategies we use to be successful as a child don't actually work for us as an adult. And so if we're still using those same strategies, so say I was shamed in school because I stood up and I did a talk and I was shamed in school. So what I did then was, well, I protected myself and I never got up and did talks anymore. Now, if I keep doing that as an adult, I'm then, I choose a job where I'm in IT and I'm always behind a computer and I never have to stand up and give any presentations. Oh, but hang on a minute. Now my job requires me to give presentations. Oh, well, I actually avoided giving presentations all my life because of that teacher that shamed me when I was a kid. So now that strategy of protecting myself and doing a job where I didn't have to get up and do presentations isn't going to work for me. So now I'm going to have to get over that and start giving presentations. And I can learn technically how to give a presentation. But then my technical presentation, if I'm still disconnected from my source of discomfort from being shamed and humiliated as a young person, I will never give the powerful presentation that I could if I was actually free of that and coming from my whole self, which is inspired and passionate about the work that I'm doing and wanting, to connect with other people about it and have people feel my sense of connection with this work. So does that make sense?
Yes, and I find it interesting how you mention the speaking example, where we could have these habits or tendencies based on things that happened very early to us, and we can let those define us for years or decades if we don't review the things we're doing, we don't review our lives. So I really think it's important to pay attention to things like that. And I couldn't help but think of another guest on the show who I had, Jamie Stenhouse, who he very similar situation. Now, he had a speaking impediment, but the idea was he wanted to get into a profession where he could never speak again. So I'm pretty sure he was an IT guy, and then eventually he had to speak. Like, this is very similar to the example you used, like almost like identical. So but the point is, like now he's a speaker. He still has the impediment, but like he's a speaker now. So and he's even able to make fun of something that was like beforehand, something that like he like despised the impediment, really set out to never speak again.
Yeah. So in a way, what he was doing was he was disowning a part of himself because he was ashamed of his impediment. So yes, he chose the vocation where he didn't have to speak. But then to be able to speak, he had to own it. He had to own and connect with his impediment as a part of him, and that he is still a whole worthy human being with the impediment and who can offer something to the world, and claim it and own it and just feel good about himself with it, and yes, and laugh about it. And so what a transformation. That is a wonderful example of a personal transformation. And the way his strategies early in life inhibit him from becoming a speaker, but then, you know, the call to be a speaker, then he had to reconnect with that source of shame or humiliation or whatever of having an impediment, overcoming that and connecting to his whole self so he could really thrive in the world and live out his potential. Wonderful example, really wonderful.
And
it doesn't have to be. I know if anyone's speaking who's a psychologist or who goes to a psychologist, there are a lot of these things. Yes, some people might need to see a psychologist to actually get to the root source of something, but not always, because psychology is a field of work that we developed, you know, in the last few hundred years. But I'm actually an educator, and so when I help people, I come from an educational focus that you know something now and you've learnt certain skills. So now you're saying you're stuck on something or blocked on something. So what are the current skills and ways of being that you're currently doing, and how are they either contributing to your success or limiting you? What other skills and senses do you need to develop in order to overcome this? So I come from much more a development of human potential perspective, not a therapeutic, you know, there's that perspective. Does that make sense?
Yes, it does. And just for breakthrough success listeners who are interested in the Jamie Stenhouse episode, we will include a link to that in the show notes, markgaberti.com/E233. And one of the things that I want to ask you, like, throughout our journeys, like, we all face several challenges. So I'm wondering if you could share with us one big challenge you faced in your journey and a powerful lesson you learned during that challenge.
Wow. Well, there have been many because I have been around for a while. If I shared with you actually probably even the first one, I became, you know, today it's very common for people to be a suitcase entrepreneur, or we have the gig economy, people working for themselves. You started it very young. Well, I actually started it very young, but a long time ago when it wasn't actually very prevalent. One of the reasons I did start it, because earlier in my day we didn't have the kind of thinking around flexible workplaces if you're a woman and you had children and this kind of thing. So I was a professional, but if I'd stayed working in an organization, it would have had to have been for me, had a limiting effect on my ability to look after family and kids and things like that. So I thought, well, okay, if I go out as a freelancer, I can sort of work my own hours. I can have my 3 o'clock appointment and pick up my kids from school, or I can block off school holidays and things like that. So it's very common today, but it wasn't common in those days. But as an individual freelance consultant, It was really funny. Most companies used to also employ what I'd say, you know, the big management consulting companies. with big teams of consultants. And there weren't that many individual consultants around. But some companies got a little bit sick of, well, the big companies have the big names, but when they contract those people, they don't get them. They'll get other people. They don't get the big name. So this particular company decided, right, well, we want a team of consultants, but we're going to choose individual consultants, you know, in their own business. So we get the lead consultant in their own right, but we need a team of them because it's a large organization. And then we want them to work together and collaborate. So I put in a bid. I won this job. It was one of my first management consultancy jobs. And so there am I. I'm young. I'm this young management consultant, and I'm thrown in now to work with five other. There's a team of six of us management consultants, and we're all working independently. And we have to collaborate for the best interests of the client. So, of course, in theory, that sounds, oh, yes, we all intentionally, we all want to collaborate. But, of course, what that then means is, well, I'm sharing all my intellectual property, the intellectual property that gets put into the pool, who then owns that? You know, there's all of these things that I think a lot of that's been sort of worked out today, but 20, 30 years ago, it was still early in the pipeline of how people would actually do that. And what I realized was that I was actually inhibiting the sharing that I was doing. I was inhibiting myself sharing, you know, the knowledge that I wanted to share to contribute because of like a fear of I'll be exploited, or I won't get recognition, or I won't be valued, you know, the more extroverted consultant or whatever will take the lead and whatever. So it was this recognition that I wanted to be a part of this team, I wanted to contribute. And you know, if you were there, you would think that I was, right? But to me, I knew that I wasn't as much as I could have been. And I wanted to look at what was limiting me. And so what was limiting me was like a fear of, you know, lack of recognition. And so my need then to be able to be vulnerable and say, well, yes, I am going to share all this information, which is what everybody does today. Everybody shares all their information and just requests that people respect where the source came from. So our respect for that has really grown over the years. And but it requires a vulnerability that a lot of people have developed. And I had to develop that in myself and develop a sense of trust that I would be okay, and that I actually also didn't necessarily always need outside recognition. You know, what was the recognition that I needed? My own internal sense of recognition of doing a good job is very, very important when you are a freelancer and independent consultant. And I think that developed in me a lot in my lifetime because of being a freelancer. You're constantly, the recognition you give yourself, the sense of fulfillment of having helping someone, or yes, you've made an impact somewhere, that's the source of fulfillment, you know, that keeps you going, not necessarily having to have somebody else pat you on the back and say you did a good job, or not even necessarily getting the next job, because maybe you don't get the next job out of it. Maybe, you know, your work comes from another source at a later date. But, yeah, so that was actually quite pivotal early in my career, recognising where I was limiting myself and how I had to overcome that. And how I had to overcome that was really, yes, once again, that getting into my senses to sense my vulnerability, to sense how I could trust myself, how I could be put all of myself in and still protect myself. Like, we still have to protect ourselves, but in a way that we can still be our whole selves. Does that make sense?
Yeah, that makes sense. I like that idea where, I mean, we have these like goals for ourselves, and we don't want to give ourselves the goals that are too small or think we can't do certain things. So it is always good to consider what is possible for you and then try to rise above and exceed the expectation that you set for yourself, raise standards, because like the limits that people impose on themselves can really hinder their ability to grow. And one of the best ways to grow, in my opinion, is to read as many books as you can get your hands on. So with that in mind, Deb, I'm wondering if you could share with us three books that you believe will have a positive impact on us.
Oh, wow. So many. Okay, well, of course, I've got to say my book, don't I? Or is this beyond my book? So my book, Trust Your Senses, I believe has a positive impact on people. And it's not just a book where it tells you what to do. It's a book that invites you to perceive how you are being in the world, how you are creating your successes or limiting yourself, and how to adapt and modify and change that. So it's a book to what I call experience, not just to think about, but to do. It's a book to do. So I would say that. And then another book, it's an older book, but if you've never read the work of Dr. Jean Houston, who what I would say is the mother of the human development movement, she wrote a book many years ago now called The Possible Human. And she's written about 50 books since then, huge amounts of resources. But Dr. Jean Houston's work is deeply profound and connecting at a personal development level. And then for people really interested in the world of business and organisations, if you haven't read Dr. Margaret Wheatley's book, the title's just gone out of my head. Sorry, the title's just gone out of my head.
It happens.
But her first book, which was published about 25 years ago, on the organisation, seeing the organisation not as a manufacturing entity, but as a living entity, as a living organism. So looking at our living world and how our living ecosystems have been sustainable and how they thrive or where they actually die, and relating that to human beings and how we create our own ecosystems in organisations, but modelling an organisation not from a machine model, not from a war model like we have in the past or an army model, but modelling how we run our organisations as a living organism. And it's dreadful, but her first book, the title has gone out of my head, but Dr. Margaret Wheatley's work. And, of course, her work shifted very much from the organisation to the individual, and she's written some beautiful books and poetry since then. So I guess the invitation in terms of books is also to read things that you wouldn't normally read. So, for example, I've just travelled up across half of Australia, and I listened to poetry, and sorry, I'll mention a third one, which is Dr. David White, W-H-Y-T-E, who's a poet and philosopher. And so I would encourage people to read things like poetry, because they evoke a connection beyond rational, technical language and words. And so if you are seeking connection, to actually look, well, actually I am reading a lot of management books or this kind of book or that, and they're often very abstract or theoretical or conceptual. What else can I read that will evoke a different response in me, a different connection? So look to poetry, story, metaphor in your reading, as well as the rational and theoretical. That's what I would invite you to do. Yeah. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I do like those book recommendations. Those will all be in the show notes, markaberry.com/E233. We will also throw in content marketing secrets in the show notes as well for anyone interested in their free copy. All you have to do is pay for shipping at markaberry.com/book. And before we wrap up this episode, Deb, I've asked you several questions throughout our time together, but what do you believe is one question that we need to be asking ourselves more often?
What am I sensing? What am I sensing right now? So all the people in organizations who are trying to, they're talking about culture and transformation. It's not what am I thinking, it's what am I sensing? What am I sensing right now in myself? What am I sensing in the room? What am I sensing in another person? And that takes us in terms of, like, you started with the connection. It shifts from our head to our body. And we haven't got the time, but it's beyond just feelings as well, because senses and also our senses are beyond just the five that we often know. In fact, neuroscientists have now said they've identified at least 33 senses. And so I think this is our time to be exploring our senses and expanding our potential and our connection through our senses. So the big question I would be asking people is, what are you sensing right now? And where are you sensing it? Are you sensing it in you, in the space, in other people? And then how are you going to make meaning out of that? What meaning does that make? How does that, how are we going to come to some different choice or different action because of what we're sensing? How does that integrate with what we're thinking? Is it opposed to what we're thinking? Does it jar with what we're thinking? It often does. Often what we're sensing and what we're thinking are two different things. But then when we fuse them, when we align them, then we are more connected. But if there's a disconnect, well, that's the opening. When there's a disconnect, there's an opening there for big learning and big shifts and big transformation.
Deb, thank you for – oh, did you have anything more to say or no?
Well, I was just going to say it's been an absolute pleasure, Mark. I have really enjoyed talking to you. I could talk to you for a lot longer, but I know we don't have time. But I wish you well in your journey, and what a great start you've made. So it's fantastic.
Deb, it was a pleasure to have you on this episode of Breakthrough Success. Anyone who wants to find Deb, you can head over to a few places. Deb Lange. .com. Get her book, Trust Your Senses. And she also has a few courses on Thinkific at deb-lang.thinkific.com. All those will be in the show notes, markaberry.com/E233. But Deb, once again, I can't thank you enough for sharing your insights with us. It was such a pleasure to have you on Breakthrough Success.
Awesome. Thank you, Mark. Wish you well.
How does over 100 retweets per day sound to you? My free ebook, 27 Ways to Get More Retweets on Twitter, has you covered. I use the methods within this ebook to get over 10,000 retweets every single quarter. To learn